and this is Gamer Culture.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Today is Monday, January 23rd, 2017. Gamer Culture is the drive, passion, and dedication to all things in gaming by the Grand Geek Gathering. The ever-changing world of gamer culture involves communities of all types, the evolving industry that surrounds us, and the people who use it for the betterment of all. Now on to character select with the question of the day. What is your favorite installment of the Kingdom Hearts series? Let's start with our newer guest. I say newer guest just because you're not on very much. Mick Failure. Hey, buddy.
How you doing? So my favorite, I'm very obsessed with Kingdom Hearts. That's one of my biggest things I'm obsessed with. Both.
That's pretty much that's why we chose the cast.
Yeah. Yeah.
I will say Kingdom Hearts 1 is nostalgia, but a fantastic game overall. That's different from all the rest, but my favorite one to play, and that I think has more depth to it, and I think a little bit more, not payoff, but just, it's the whole end of it, especially the final fight, really, really brings out all my emotions. It's going to be Birth by Sleep on the PSP. Like, even just playing something handheld, like, we played a lot of things handheld, Pokemon, and a bunch of other games that, you know, that really capture a lot of emotions and stuff like that. But I'm playing it on this tiny screen, this game, and it's just draining me. And Birth by Sleep is just one of those games that's just, like, so, for me, like, it really completed kind of, like, everything I wanted as to, it answered all these questions I always wanted to know. Why Sora? Why not Roxas? Or, sorry, mm-hmm. why not Riku? And everything around it, what is a Keyblade and why, and how it chooses. So, I think Birth by Sleep
is all that answered in Aqua's storyline? Because I finished a 2 out of 3, and I haven't gotten any of those answers yet.
Yes, actually, every single one of those answers in Aqua's storyline.
Yeah, okay. Aqua's storyline is, like, the most important.
I am so happy, and I know that you just started, the game, I'm so happy that you saved her for last, because I did her first, and which I know. I didn't mean like that, but I did her storyline first, and I regret that so much this day that I did her storyline first, my first playthrough. But it's gonna be Birth by Sleep. Okay.
Next up, S Book. Welcome back, as always. By the way, I had a really weird thing with your name. It just clicked because of your Twitter handle. It's S Bookworm.
Yeah.
I didn't know that until I saw your Twitter handle. and I added you. I'm like, oh my god, Bookworm would have been such a better thing to be calling you than just S Book.
But you're on Twitter?
Yeah, I am.
You can check the Gamer Culture Twitter and see her handle and follow her for all of her awesome
I don't. I don't tweet a lot because I'm really bad at remembering to tweet, but I do get on and look. So if someone tweets me and starts having a conversation with me, I will talk back to them. So, it's not.
Would you mind if we called you Bookworm from here on out instead of S Book?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You go for it. Cool.
Sweet. Bookworm. Go ahead.
So my favorite game is actually, I had to go through all the games because I like them all for different reasons, even the ones that I actually are like at the lower part of the totem pole. And I decided to choose one because we're playing through one. It's not nostalgia blindness. When playing through one, there's a lot of little things that I find charming that aren't in all the other games. The example I used before we started actually doing the podcast today was, for example, if you're in Traverse Town and you're in the scale in Huey, Dewey, and Louie's shop, you can put Sora on it and it'll actually show his weight. And that adds nothing to the story.
I never noticed that.
Yeah, it adds nothing to the story, but it's like a little cute thing. And there's so many of that in just the entire game. It also, the storyline wasn't as convoluted as it is. Don't get me wrong, I love the convoluted storyline, but it was...
Oh, robot.
Wait. Every other word here.
Give her a sec.
Give it a sec. Give her a sec.
Simple.
Come on, Bookworm, you can do
this.
Oh,
no!
Wait for it.
Are you back?
Is she back?
Are you back?
Okay. Am I back?
Welcome
yes,
back.
Yes, right. Back. Welcome back.
Okay, okay. The storyline, well, anyway, as I was saying, the storyline wasn't as convoluted as it is in, like, later games. And then also, it was one of the very few games and the first game that I completed 100%. So, like, all of the extra bosses and everything, and I got the ultimate Keyblade, so it's, like, got this little special place in my heart because of that, so.
All right.
All righty. Card, what was your favorite game in the series, bud?
I'm sorry to McFailure. I know you hate it, but I'm going to have to choose number two. Like, Kingdom Hearts 2. Because, just because of the timing it came out.
How dare you have an opinion.
Yeah, I know. Also, I love Chain of Memories. I know a lot of people didn't like Chain of Memories. I loved Chain of Memories. Because think of it when it came out. It was in high school. I was in high school when it came out. Like, I played the original, and then I played Chain of Memories, and I liked it. And then I played the second game, and it was like, oh, they're referencing Chain of Memories. Oh, that's so cool. It's like a connected universe or something. And then,
these games are connected or something.
And then after that, it was just, you know, all exploded out from there. I have a love-hate relationship with Birth by Sleep. Like, apparently I've only played the two unimportant storylines.
No, they're important for the reason. Aqua connects everything together.
Like, I remember originally playing Terra's, and I remember the bosses being really, really hard. Probably because I didn't grind at all until, like, the very end. And then I recently finished Ventus's today, which I did go back and, like, I grinded. I won Ars Arcanum. I got that really early, and that set me ahead of the level curve, and that made everything easy, except for the final boss, which was bullshit.
Well, I hated playing as Terra, so I feel that. I hated playing as Terra because, so if you've never played Birth by Sleep, they each have their own specialties. Like, so Terra is really strong, but he's super slow, like, compared to the other two, and I hate slow characters, so he was the worst one to play for me.
Yeah, I remember playing through as him. I realized I have to block. I can't dodge things. I have to learn how to block. And it's great because he got a reflect block. It's like, oh, cool. People throw projectiles at me. I block them. They reflect back. That's a main source of damage for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. All right.
And what about you, Kuma? You're up next.
My favorite in the series was, and I'm going to have to copy card. I'm going to have to say two. And it's my favorite because... It's pretty much my favorite for why everyone else hates it, it seems. I loved the flashier combat. I loved the reaction. I loved the reaction commands. So many people hated the reaction commands.
I like them too.
Here's the thing. In Kingdom Hearts 1, I like the combat was great, but let's be real. The combat was basically spam X win game with the occasional dodge. The only way combat got flashy was when you used one of your specials. So, you know, like Strike Raid, Sonic Thrust?
Sonic Rush.
Sonic Rush, Ars Arcanum, Ragnarok, any of those.
One, but all of that was in one as well.
Here's the thing. No, I'm saying that was the good thing about one.
Oh.
But, like, that made combat flashy. Other than that, combat was boring as fuck in Kingdom Hearts. It was just spam X. In Kingdom Hearts 2. Combat got a lot more flashy. The reaction commands gave you interesting ways to kill an enemy other than just hit them with X a bunch of times. My hands down favorite one in the whole game that wasn't a boss one was against the Bushido nobody, the samurai. Because if you use the reaction command, you like clash and then you like sit there like this, and all of your attack options became question marks. One of them would pop up. I think it was called Bushido. You had to quickly get to it, attack, you'd cut through them and kill them in one hit, and they would yield a bunch more experience and a bunch more the chance for items would go way up than if you just killed them normally. That's awesome. And it made the fights like so much more exciting and big. Like Kingdom Hearts 1 wasn't lacking in big effects and big sets during the fight, but Kingdom Hearts 2 upped that ante. When you were in the first time you beat the Pride Lands, when you have to fight the giant behemoth, and the reaction command is fucking run under this thing's feet while it's trying to trample you, and then mm-hmm. spin up to its head and Legolas it, like, that was awesome. I loved that shit.
I hated that world.
Also, oh. I loved the forms. Now, I didn't use all of them for the purpose of enjoyment necessarily. I used them as a way to get the abilities for the most part. But, like, I know Valor, you unlocked High Jump. Wisdom.
Final Form gave you a glide.
Final Form gave you glide, and you had to level up Final Form all the way to the end so that you would continue to not only quickly glide, but when you reached the ground, you wouldn't automatically land. You would only land if you hit a solid surface or if you stopped.
Yeah.
But Final Form was awesome. It was super flashy. It dealt a ton of damage. It was such a bitch to grind, and when you finally got it, you were super excited because the only way to level Final Form was to enter Final Form and then kill nobodies with it.
The only way to get Final Form was, it was random.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was random. If you use it in the world that never was, the first time you use a form, it's automatic. And then any time after that, it's random. But then when you get it on the random time, then you can access it at any time.
Yeah. So you had to get it. The first time was random, but you could get it every other time after that. Yeah. Unless you got the weird heartless mistake phase.
If any time, once you actually unlocked Final Form was the only one that you didn't have a chance of activating Shadow Sora.
Yeah.
Also, and Shadow Sora was a bitch.
That was a fucking pain. Ugh. See, that's why I didn't do it. Like, I understand, like, I don't know. For me, I like the hack and slash. I like the fact that I'm going around doing dash, doing dodge roll and using different magic and using that strategy of, do I use the special, attack here, or, like Arcanum, whatever it's called. And, I don't know, that's what I liked about one. And they also did that a lot in Birth by Sleep, I feel, for me. Yeah, they had Dry Form, but I never used it. I never used Dry Form, ever, in any of the games. I think it's just a waste.
Yeah.
The biggest thing I'll give one over two are all the optional bosses. All the optional fights that you can do. You got Sephiroth, you've got the Phantom, you've got the Ice Titan and the Rock Titan, and you've got, what was his name? It was like a dude's name, because it was someone who won a contest. Kurt Zisa. Those were really great, because Kingdom Hearts 2 didn't really have secret bosses. There was Sephiroth, and then there was the upper echelons of the Hades tournament.
Yeah.
No. Kurt Zisa also came back in Kingdom Hearts 2, and there were a couple others.
Kurt Zisa in 2?
Yes.
I haven't played Final Mix yet, but they also cut out a few boxes in the American version that are in Final Mix.
They cut out so many, which was a big thing for 2.5, because you have all the different kind of mushrooms. You have and Kurt Zisa.
He might have been, let's see.
Oh, you're right. Sorry, I thought he was in Kingdom Hearts 2 for some reason.
He was in 1.5, he was in the final mix,
I can't wait to play against him when Final Mix comes out in PS4.
Same.
Well, next month, right? March?
March.
No, it got moved to March, I think. I don't know. Anyway. I've got my copy on reserve.
I pre-ordered as soon as possible. Every single game I pre-ordered.
So, I am going to agree with Kuma on this one, because I liked the forms and I liked the special moves, but I will admit that it gave the developers chances to be lazy when they shouldn't have. So my thing is I love the boss fights from Kingdom Hearts. I really, the whole series, but there are some that just really suck have lost potential. And to me,
for kids, and then those extra bosses are the ones for the actual gamers. Like, cool. Everything's cute and all.
No. That's not my complaint. My complaint is that they use the reaction commands to cheap out on a boss. Like, for example, the genie Jafar in Kingdom Hearts 2 is so cheap because they basically rely on a really simple reaction command. There's really no way to die during that fight. I've tried. And so it just seems like they just cheaped out and they were like, we've got this reaction command, that's how they'll beat it. And that circumstances where they did that.
Wow.
That was weird.
Your robot, and then it caught up.
Yeah. Every sound that it lagged on, it threw into about a 2-second window. Are you frozen now?
Yeah, I think she is.
Yeah. Oh.
All right. Yeah, I know what you mean. It seems like it cheapened out.
So, am I unfrozen?
Now you are.
Now you are. She lives. Okay, you were saying, Card?
Oh, yeah. I recently replayed the final boss for Kingdom Hearts 2, and it's just spam triangle. Spam X and spam triangle.
And I totally get that. I absolutely agree that they cheaped out on a lot of fights. The simplicity of Kingdom Hearts 1 definitely made it so that these mechanics are terrifying because all I have is attack, dodge, and block. And I have to figure out exactly which ones to do at the right time and where I should be targeting. The mechanics of it made it better. I get that. But I just loved the flashiness of Kingdom Hearts 2. I loved that it was so much more fun to look at, and it was so much more fun to execute. Like I said, it went from press X to do, like, you know, to beat the hell out of an enemy and just like, okay, I'm doing the same shit I've done to every single boss since, to I'm doing the same shit. Oh, now I do something cool.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I can understand that, but I don't know. Like, if they were to implement that, a lot of those bosses in Kingdom Hearts 2 were not that exciting. The only ones that was the one, I'm forgetting his name, the Organization 13 member, outside of Beast's Mansion. Like,
Zaldin.
Oh, fuck. I love that fight. But there wasn't one for that, really, until he did, like, the one thing where all of them were coming at you. But, like that. Those action commands would have been great for that fight. But the one that they used so much in the ballroom where Belle and Beast dance, that was a dumb fight in the dumbest way for you to
use. Here's the thing, though, because if you look at the pattern of Kingdom Hearts 2, it was visit all the worlds, defeat some sort of heartless that's infected that world. Then you go back to, God, where did you go back to? You didn't go back to
Hollow Bastion.
To Twilight. Yeah, you go back to Hollow Bastion. Shit goes insane, and then you revisit every world, and they're having a problem. They're usually having a problem with a member of the organization. Not always.
Yeah.
I think in Nightmare Before Christmas, the first time you go there, it's Oogie Boogie is in. You're stopping him in Santa's workshop. And then the second time you go back, there's like a giant heartless that you have to kill in the off to the side somewhere, or maybe I'm getting those mixed. But that was pretty much that. Yeah, it's like you go there once and deal with a heartless. You go there again and deal with an organization member.
Well, lying, for example, the Lion King world. The first time you do it, there's a giant heartless, and you have to take back the world from Scar, so you have to fight off the heartless. And then the next time you go, Simba's having. Well, no, Simba's having doubts about whether he can lead, and you have to fight off Ghost Scar.
That's right, so. Ghost Scar, would randomly replace a pack of enemies that was supposed to spawn. I remember that.
Yeah.
That's right, because it was Pete. Pete and Maleficent were screwing with worlds, too.
Yeah.
Yes. And that was honestly my favorite fucking part about Kingdom Hearts 2, was Maleficent and Pete. Timeless River was perfect. There's no... Mm-hmm. I love the Organization 13, obvious from my fucking hoodie.
I do too, and I get shit for it. I love the Organization.
But you know what? They kind of make Kingdom Hearts 2 a little worse. I think if it was Maleficent just... I think if they were secondary and they really focused on Maleficent really trying again, that would have been cooler. Like, you going to Timeless River was crazy and awesome. And then her basically being like, I messed up because I trusted too many people. Now I have to take things in my own hand. I think Maleficent is a big enough character, and also it would have made more sense from the first game to the second game to have her as a main villain. And Organization 13 being like, oh, I remember them from Chain of Memories, and have them be secondary up until the end. That would have been cool.
Have them be pawns to Maleficent.
It feels like they could have taken two games and they pushed it into one.
Okay.
Is what you guys are saying.
I agree with that completely. No. But I like the fact that they were in both games. I just wish Maleficent was the primary and Organization 13 was just kind of there. And you're just like, I remember these guys from Chain of Memories, but why are they here? And I would have been okay with them taking over the whole ending. And then, like, you defeating Maleficent, thinking the game's over. And then it's just like, nope, Organization 13. And then that would open up all the sequels, like 358 by 2. Like Birth by Sleep, like, or not, well, not as much Birth by Sleep, but with Dream Drop Distance. Organization, they're a huge deal. However, they're never the major threat until the end of Kingdom Hearts 2. And that would have been cool if we just, that they were just kind of entity of like, I don't know who these people are. Why am I fighting them so much? Like, why, like, I wish that they were, you just kind of like, you had Chain of Memory to establish Organization 13 exists. It's a big deal. Then you have Kingdom Hearts 2, where it's just, you're doing the same thing, and you have the same villain, Maleficent, Riku, all that stuff, trying to find Riku. I don't know why they had to initially make Organization 13 such a big deal. It makes no sense, because I love every single thing Maleficent does in Kingdom Hearts 2.
It made no sense unless you played Chain of Memories. And that was, a lot of people didn't play Chain because they couldn't either get past the battle system or they just didn't know about it.
Yeah.
So, you know, people were like, who are these random people? And I could see that as someone who actually played Chain. And I see the confusion.
I don't get that. Like, people couldn't get past the battle system in Chain. You stack your deck with nines, you put a few zeros at the beginning and give yourself a few cures. Boom,
I hated
you
it.
Win. You win. No.
As a person who had a problem with Chain, which Card should know very well because Card had to beat both storylines for me. I played through all of them back in high school. I would play through all of them, and then at each final boss, I was like, dude, I can't do this. Do you want to beat it for me?
Okay.
I had problems with... God, every time I have a problem in the first few games, always a freaking Riku fight. The very last Riku replica fight,
I want to go back,
was the hardest one.
I can't wait until the 1.5, 2.5 comes out for PS4, because I want to play that Riku fight again.
I want to play it again. I want to play it again in 3D.
I remember that fight. I remember it gave me so much trouble in the past. I want to face it now.
I want to play it again in 3D, because I played it on Game Boy Advance.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if it's different. So.
Okay. What's coming out in March? It's all the games together.
Yeah. Okay. So, moving forward for, you know, obviously the topic of the day is Kingdom Hearts. And we want to look, you know, so what are we looking forward to with the future of the franchise? We've got tomorrow, the 24th. We've got 2.8.
At the time of this recording, it's tomorrow.
At the time of this recording, it's tomorrow. Tomorrow will be the 24th of January. It's going to be Kingdom Hearts 2.8 Prologue. Fuck, what's the final?
Back cover.
No, back cover is something else.
Yeah, it's 2.8 Final Mix Final Chapter Prologue. It comes with Aqua storyline. It comes with Dream Drop Distance. And it comes with the back cover.
Yeah. And with all of those, so we're getting that, and then
all
in March.
PS4. And then March is 1.5 and 2.5 Final Mix.
Yes.
It's all the games, and then for the two games they could not convert, which is Recoded and 358-2, you get a movie with all the cutscenes.
Yeah. So we're getting all of that, and all of this is supposed to lead into Kingdom Hearts 3. Now, what we don't know is necessarily where 2.8 fits, since you've got... Well, we've got the Birth by Sleep shit. We've got the 0.2 Birth by Sleep, which is supposed to be with Birth by Sleep, which is bef- 4, Kingdom Hearts 1. And then we've... So it's... Like, weird.
This timeline's more convoluted than the Zelda one at this point.
We also have Birth Bot, or we also have Dream Drop Distance, which is after supposed 2. To take place right. Yeah, after 2, supposed to take place right before 3, because it's Sora and Riku getting ready for their Mark of Mastery.
Mm-hmm.
To decide which one's going to be the Keyblade Master. Of course it's gonna be Sora. Failure.
Okay, so
some people think it's going to be Riku.
Wait, who is?
Going to be the Keyblade Master. Gonna pass the Mark of Mastery.
Okay, so it's always gonna start with Kingdom Hearts Key, which was the multiplayer game, the online game that was.
Wait, was that the one the cell phone?
No, it was recoded.
So, then it was a browser game.
There was another one that was on the phone. Cards Right, I played it.
An app. It's an app. Sorry. It was on originally like a phone, a browser
right
to an app. Counting recoded. And then it goes to Birth by Sleep, and then Birth by Sleep, a Fragment Passage, actually Aqua Story, goes from right after Birth by Sleep all the way to kind of 358x2. All that, because Aqua's stuck in Kingdom Hearts for years.
Well, 358 Days and Kingdom Hearts are kind of coterminous. They're kind of going on at the same time.
Kind of.
358 Days starts during Kingdom Hearts.
Yeah, well, at the end. I mean, remember, you're at Hollow Bastion, and Hollow Bastion's the second last world.
It begins during Kingdom Hearts, and then it runs kind of concurrently with Chain of Memories.
Yes. Yeah, exact same time. So you get the back cover that is actually at the exact same time as the end of Key. And then with 258, then you have Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep, but then you have the Fragmented Passage that goes along with Kingdom Hearts, and then you have 358x2, and then Chain of Memories also happens at the exact same time as 358x2, right after Kingdom Hearts.
Like, if you really want to get technical, you have Kingdom Hearts. 358 Days starts during Kingdom Hearts. Kingdom Hearts ends, we go into Chain of Memories.
Yep.
Most of 358 Days over 2 happens during Chain of Memories.
Yep.
Chain of Memories ends, then Kingdom Hearts 358 Days over 2 ends.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of choppy. Technically, it spans like 3 games, one like the end being its own.
Yeah, and then Kingdom Hearts 2, then you have Recoded, then you have Dream Drop Distance.
Which, if you want to get technical, Japan had Coded, America had Recoded.
Yes. Coded was a mobile game with a flip phone, and I actually got to play it through lots of different fucked up things that I did with a phone. I got to play it in Japanese years ago. It was really weird. But of course, it didn't play anything like the DS that you can get this Recoded, or the movie that's in 2.5. And then you have Dream Drop Distance, and apparently, until 2.8... was going to exist. We were supposed to have a sequel for Birth by Sleep that was called supposed to be called Aqua's
Yes.
Something about Aqua. And
it was about her leading a team of anorexic teens. It was gonna be Aqua's Teen Hunger Force.
Oh god.
Good night, everybody.
But they created it for this game, and they teased it. There was even a teaser trailer in Japan in the we would get a release, and then they would get like the unlocked release. What was it called? Mm-hmm. Anyway, whatever.
Remix? Remix?
Yeah, Remix. It was in the Birth by Sleep Remix of Japan. They got a teaser trailer for a sequel that featured only Aqua in Kingdom Hearts, and that's essentially what a Fragment Passage is going to be. But it's going to take years, because that's the whole issue, is like, in Kingdom Hearts 3, we're essentially going to save her. She's still stuck there, and we have to get her out.
Yeah.
Oh, she's stuck in, like...
It's going to take years? I thought the game was only going to be, like, one world long.
What do you mean? A Fragmentary Passage,
yeah.
a fragment passage is probably going to be all these worlds that were, like, okay, so Sean and I went to GameStop Expo. If you haven't seen the video before, we got to play a little bit of it. And every world is so fucked up and so messed up and blarred.
There, you know? Okay, it really makes sense when you realize the part that we were playing is probably what they're calling here 0.2 Birth by Sleep, a fragmentary passage.
Yeah.
We were playing in a kingdom that was literally floating in nothing, broken up into pieces. Floating in front of, I think, was the castle from Chain of Memories?
Yes. It's supposed to be Chain of Memories. Remember, because we walked up and then we had to...
Yeah.
Play. The whole passage is basically her going through Chain of Memories and basically her restoring what memories are as it keeps going. Because Chain of Memories takes away your memory. It's basically, it subdues you and you get lost the farther you go.
Well, to be fair, that was Namine stealing Sora's memories the longer he was there.
But Aqua is also aware, and yeah, that's true. But Aqua may be more powerful than Namine, right?
Yeah.
I'd hope so.
Yeah. Namine runs like her. They call her a witch a lot in the English in the English of both Chain of Memories and Kingdom Hearts 2. Really, like, the only, like, her thing is, like, yeah, she can, like, steal memories, but they're like, I guess that constitutes her being a witch.
Well, but she right? It's
a
Japanese to American game, so there's probably some weird translation going on. But yeah, she does it a few times, but she does a lot of, I don't know, she meddles. So she can take memories away, and she can
plant them. She can incept.
Yeah, that too. So they use her, but she's not... I think she's done a lot more than we've actually seen. That's my personal theory, because she wasn't really in line with the organization, and she was more than willing to betray them several times.
She's the only
bridge, and did.
She's the only bridge between Kingdom Hearts and the Organization 13. The whole thing about Kingdom Hearts 2 was for them to get into open Kingdom Hearts, but they couldn't. They had her who the bridge in between.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I think it'd be like so, like.
Well, actually.
By the way, you want to get really complicated on the timeline? The timeline I'm reading includes secret endings in the timeline. The ones that are considered like the canon, like this is like the ending to this game. Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep, 0.2 Birth by Sleep, Fragmentary Passage. Blank Points, which is the final secret ending of Birth by Sleep. Blank Points begins before Kingdom Hearts, does not end until right before Dream Drop Distance. It actually goes Recoded, Signs of What's Next, and Destiny, which are both secret endings of Coded, then Blank Points, then DDD.
You know, I remember people complaining about the Zelda timeline because they're like, it makes no sense. And I like look at the Kingdom Hearts timeline that people have made, and I was like, yeah, Zelda's got nothing on this mess.
Zelda at least has a semblance of like, here's where things branch. They acknowledge that there's like, there are splits in the timeline of like failure states and what shit that happens like that. Kingdom Hearts is just like, it's like, oh, where does this end? Where does this begin? Well, it's more like this goes on during this and then kind of bleeds into this. And this is all going on during this time, but we only actually see it here. It's weird. So what do we think for Kingdom Hearts 3? You know, we've got, how many people have played DDD.
But Kingdom Hearts has more characters than Zelda. We have Organization 13.
I know.
Heartless. We have Riku. We have Sora. We have Mickey. Mm-hmm. We have everything else. I mean, and that's the thing, is that where all the other games, you know, kind of go to.
Yep. Oh, I know. I'm not comparing the two series. I just was making a joke because a lot of people complain about the Zelda timeline, and I'm just like, it's not bad.
I'm like different dimensions.
So, Bookworm, being the only one here who's actually played DDD, Where do you see this?
No, Tyler's played it.
Okay. He's played it too. So to both of you guys, and I can't see Card because...
No, I have not played it.
Okay. Yeah, just so in case, you know, people don't know, you can all see Card. We can't because he's capturing a separate screen. So to us, he just looks like a couple of penguins.
Mm-hmm. And they're damn majestic penguins.
They're majestic as fuck. But yeah, Card is penguins right now. Put that on a shirt. Wild Card is penguins. So to you two have actually played it. Where do you see this leading into Kingdom Hearts 3? With as convoluted as Kingdom Hearts is, I know nothing about DDD. I know shit about the story. What are we being led into? What's happening?
Chaos. Absolute chaos. Okay, okay.
Yeah, essentially. Because
we're coming up on an hour almost, believe it. About 15 more minutes.
Dream Drop Distance is the closest to Kingdom Hearts 3 that we're going to get. And they've been saying that for a long time. And pardon me for a split second. It's Dan!
Is that Dan?
Hi!
Anyway, okay, so...
How many times do we have to defeat the darkness before it's gone?
All the times.
Like, how many times do we have to go through big flashy cutscenes to finally be like, yo, this guy's dead?
Okay, so...
I have stabbed this guy, like, 37 times now, and he's not dead yet. I bathed him in light, and he's not dead yet.
Dream Drop Distance basically affirms that Xehanort is alive and well. You get a lot more answers. It does convolute the story a little bit more, but it also answers a lot of questions as well. But it gives you a great idea as to what Kingdom Hearts 3 has in store. Story-wise,
everyone gets a keyblade.
You get a keyblade.
But
you get a key.
But that's how it was before.
I know.
And they explain that when you see, like, especially like in Kingdom Hearts 2 and the remix, you know, special ending, you see all those keyblades that you saw in
the keyblade.
In
the
you do.
The beginning of Chain of Memories, that whole crossroads thing. You see that the crossroads thing is actually a graveyard of keyblades. This has happened all the time, where one person has a keyblade and everybody around them gets one as well. So the fact that Kairi and Riku get one is weird, but the thing is that they've now established that's what happens. One person gets a keyblade, the ones who surround him get him as well because they're just as strong as he is.
Is it more like anyone can get a keyblade, or you have a keyblade master and then their presence sort of like trickles down and everyone associated with them can get one too?
Yes, but only if they
remember their hearts are connected. It's all about hearts. It's all about connecting. So basically you are best friends making a raft with the Keyblade Master. You're most likely going to get a Keyblade.
All right, so does it trickle down from, like, say Kuma's a Keyblade Master, we all get one. Someone that Kuma doesn't even know that I'm friends with gets a Keyblade because I'm a Keyblade Master now as well.
No.
Does it just spread out like that?
Your hearts have to be connected. Riku and Sora are connected to a Palfu fruit, and then the Wayfinder and Kairi are connected in between. It doesn't have to be materialistic things, but the thing is that they're symbols. You're connected through symbols. You're connected through things that you go through that really bring you together.
Say Riku has a friend that Sora doesn't know about that has another connection. Since Riku has a Keyblade, does that mean that guy, like Joe Schmo, that Riku's really good friends with, gets a Keyblade as well?
He sold Sora a burrito once.
You know what?
He sold Sora a burrito once.
You know what? Sora's mom's one line in Kingdom Hearts 1, I would love for her to come back for no fucking reason with a Keyblade. I mean, like, fuck you, dude! It's like, he's like, hands off my sons, you assholes!
Not my son, you bitch!
Yeah,
they
have her waist down. Don't just keyblade come out, and it's just like that.
It's waist down, so she's holding the keyblade with her foot.
She's a keyblade master with her foot.
I'll teach you to make my son miss dinner for 20 years.
God, no. Do you realize how cold his dinner's gotten?
but yeah, like I think it's they say your heart has to be connected. I think there's obviously more to it because everybody doesn't just get a Keyblade. I think you have to be also does.
So you mean like Tidus, Waka, and oh no, it's not Tidus. Oh, who's on the island with them? Sophie.
No, it is Tidus. It's Tidus, Waka, and Selfie.
Tidus, Waka, yeah. Selfie.
They all get Keyblades now.
Sophie?
Selfie.
Selfie?
Yeah, Selfie.
Yeah.
Selfie.
Is she the original Selfie?
Yes, she is.
S. The original Selfie. S. It's spelled S-E-L-P-H-I-E. It's Selfie, but not like Selfie. Like, hey, let's take a selfie. Like, no.
So, do they get Keyblades now?
No. Okay. No. So, they also explain why Mickey gets one as well.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, it's all about the strength of your heart. It also, it's about,
it's kind of like DBZ, where power levels are bullshit.
No, it's more about Mickey's aware. He knew Ansem. He knew Xehanort. He knew he was kind of always around in his world. Essentially, they're making him immortal. Mickey is essentially immortal. He's been around for years.
So he's more of a force of good than an individual.
He's a big part of Birth by Sleep. So, and he has a bit. Well, kind of, I guess, because he was still an apprentice at least at one point. I don't know. Mickey's, you know what, out of all the history, I think Mickey's is the one that doesn't make any sense the most.
Mickey is the wild card in this series, like...
Hey-o.
No,
Mickey.
Yeah. Hey. He makes no sense.
In Kingdom Hearts 2, they make it a big deal saying that he's an apprentice, and then... Oh, no, that was... No, never mind. No, it makes sense. He was an apprentice in Birth by Sleep. Right? What?
No, he wasn't.
Yeah.
He was apprenticed to Yen Sid.
I know
that's all we know about his apprenticeship, right?
Game where that was a big deal. What was the game that made him a big deal that he was an apprentice? It wasn't Kingdom Hearts 2. It had to be Birth by Sleep.
It wasn't Birth by Sleep.
Are you sure? Because he's a big deal in Aqua Story, and you haven't been there yet. I'm telling... Bookworm and I are telling you, it's all about Aqua Story.
It really is.
Okay.
Aqua is my favorite character of Kingdom Hearts.
So here's a really interesting thing, and we're coming up on an hour, and I'm loving the conversation, but let's get a little topic-y here. Well, really quick kind of last focus bit before we'll end the recording, and we're going to keep streaming. We're going to keep talking kill. People have to go. But we've heard from Nomura that Kingdom Hearts 3 is the end of Sora's story, but it's not the end of Kingdom Hearts.
Oh, yeah, they're going to milk this for all they can.
Wait. I'm sorry. What did you say?
Kingdom Hearts 3 is the end of Sora's story. It's the end of this arc. It's the end of the story they've been telling. It is not the end of Kingdom Hearts.
No.
So, yes, like Card said, they're going to milk this cash cow until the others bleed, but... That means there's more history, there's more story. Who knows, maybe they'll be telling stories as prequels, maybe they'll continue the storyline. It's going to be really interesting to see what else has to be told, what else they want to tell, what's going to happen in 3, that there's more to this.
I have a theory.
What's up?
I have a theory that...
Is it a theory or a hypothesis?
Or a hypotenuse.
Hypothesis, I guess. A theory.
Got it.
I think Sora is going to give himself completely heart. Kingdom Hearts is going to be turned into light. And what the next round of games are going to be Sora, Donald and Goofy, Mickey, and somebody else who are going to basically try to fight off the darkness. Because it has to be different planes. We have the Unversed. We have all these other things that kind of don't make any more sense. They need to travel through. Because I think them creating the Unversed was honestly, I think, is their biggest mistake. Because they made things...
The Unverse were the main enemies in Birth by Sleep. They're nothing. Don't even worry about them. They were created by Vanitas just to bug Ventus.
Pretty much.
Yeah, that's all they are. That's it.
That's really what they are.
I love Vanitas. I think what it is it's going to be... Sora's going to be gone. I think he's going to give in completely to make Kingdom Hearts light, and there's going to be a different force. There's going to be something else. What Nomura has said in past interviews and other people as well, that it's not Sora Saga, it's Xehanort Saga. The end of Kingdom Hearts 3 is going to end Xehanort. So there's going to be a different villain. There's going to be a different...
Do you think we're still going to have Sora? It's the villain that he was talking about?
Sora's either going to be Yen Sid, or he is going to be Kingdom Hearts.
He's going to be Yen Sid?
You know what? Kingdom Hearts MMO. After Kingdom Hearts 3, he's going to be an MMO after that.
Everyone gets a Keyblade!
I think Square Enix has learned otherwise. Not to do that.
You touched a door handle that Sora touched once? Keyblade!
I served him burrito.
You shot in the same toilet. Keyblade!
Oh, God.
Sensumi!
I honestly... So, they've mentioned the Keyblade War a couple of times. I kind of think it's like a cycle, and I think Xehanort's really... He's actually a really good villain because he's tricky in the sense that he's made so many ways not to die that...
God, he's Voldemort.
He basically is Voldemort. He's freaking Voldemort.
I think he underestimates himself.
Let her talk!
I think he can still be killed, and I think that's what's going to happen. I agree with you there. I think the end of Kingdom Hearts 3 is finally going to do him in, but I think it's going to set off another Keyblade War. So I think that it going forward is going to be about that. That's my theory, anyway.
Well, the Keyblade War was supposed to be a tease for Key, to be honest. Kingdom Hearts Key. That, the whole, every single one of these special endings would mention... Would mention or reference a Keyblade War. A lot of it actually was a tease for Key. Because
is a tease for a shitty cell phone game.
No, it is. and I agree.
It's the most expensive trailer for a cell phone game.
To me, Cube was the dumbest shit in the world. I couldn't get into it. Like, stand the appeal, but I personally couldn't get into it. Xehanort's going to die, but they have to come up with something else, and they've been planning it for a long time. It's either going to be the final boss, or it's going to be the special ending, but we are going to know who the next villain is going to be.
The next villain is going to be Sora.
Oh, man.
That would be...
Sora falls to darkness?
No, it wouldn't even be that. It would be Vanitas.
Do you think... Well, would they, though? Because... To me, if they want to say this is the end of the Xehanort saga, then it's the end of Xehanort and everyone associated with him.
That would be like
saying this is the end of the Frieza saga, and the villain of the next one is Ginyu.
You know what it'll be? It's going to be Vanitas is going to come back, and Sora is going to complete him.
That'll be confusing. Sora defeats someone that looks exactly like him.
Well, half of Sora... is Ventus.
It's Sora, Ventus, and Roxas in a big melee.
Well, you know that, so in Kingdom Hearts 3, obviously they're going to find Aqua, but they're also going to fix Ventus. They have to, I feel like. So doing that might actually affect and change Sora in ways we haven't really thought.
It's going to be all three of them coming together.
We're going to have to wrap this up.
Okay.
Any final thoughts for the recording?
Yeah. Any final thoughts on the future of Kingdom Hearts? Going? What the stuff that we've seen means?
I want more interesting boss fights.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Like, what I saw in Birth by Sleep was awesome. I want more of that.
Okay.
I want more answers instead of questions.
if you don't pay attention to it and you don't think about it, it all works out.
But it's like every time we get a question solved, we get like 14 more questions, and I'm like, I hate this, but I love it.
And it's true. Well, that's because Nomura didn't get to make the game that he originally wanted to make. And of course, he wanted Sora to be a lion person with a chainsaw, weapon.
What?
Yep.
Oh, you didn't know that? Yeah.
No, we're gonna talk about that in the post show.
I gotta go find something. Okay, when we're done with post show, I gotta find something real quick in my room, and then I'll come right back. But I'm not leaving. But I gotta show something that's connected to the lion thing. But let's keep continuing.
Okay.
I have the book version right over here.
All right, McFailure, final thoughts.
I want them to not be flashy. I want them to understand that we've been waiting for this game for a very long time. And I don't want them to do what Final Fantasy 15 fell through, was to make it so different and to make it so for new. I don't want them to focus it on being to bring in new people into this world. I want them to focus it on to ending this arc of this world, of this universe. Because Kingdom Hearts 15, when you play it, when Final Fantasy 15. When you put it on, it says, "Oh, it's the it's a Final Fantasy game for new players." I don't want that. I want it to be for the people who've been playing Kingdom Hearts to end it. I'm okay. Fine. Put in the drives, the stupid new parade shit that they're putting in, but nothing else. Just do that, and keep it with the heart of everything else. Put in cute, nostalgic things like the 101 Dalmatians, the letters thing, something. Make Maleficent a big deal. Because Maleficent is the perfect.
How many times have we killed her, though?
It's not that, though. It's the fact that she's the only one who completely understands it. And I want them to really learn from Kingdom Hearts, Dream Drop Distance and Kingdom Hearts 1. As to what Kingdom Hearts is, and that's all I ask. All
right, cool.
So cut out the fluff and go back to the more interesting characters. The thing I want to see is pretty much what Bookworm said. You know, let's get some goddamn answers up in here. Give us a solid ending that we can actually say, okay, this is an ending where I can say loose ends are tied up, everything's good, everyone is accounted for, we can move on to a different saga. And I want combat that doesn't rely on the cheapness that was brought on by the reaction commands, but also is still as engaging and as flashy as Kingdom Hearts 2. Yeah. I love the bosses of Kingdom Hearts 1. They had a